Would the congregation please stand? We receive the body of our brother Jim with confidence in God, the giver of life, who raised the Lord Jesus from the dead. Grant, Lord, that we who are baptized in the death of your Son, our Saviour Jesus Christ, may continually put to death our evil desires and be buried with him, that through the grave and gate of death we may pass to our joyful resurrection through his merits, who died and was buried and rose again for us, your Son Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. I am the resurrection and the life, says the Lord. Those who believe in me, even though they die, yet shall they live. And everyone who lives and believes in me shall never die. I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. We brought nothing into this world. We can take nothing out. The Lord gave, and the Lord is taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Would you please be seated? May I, on behalf of St. McCartan's Cathedral, extend my deepest and heartfelt sympathy to the family circle on the loss of Jim. May I welcome you all here this afternoon, and may I welcome especially those who are viewing online now and those who will view online later this evening. Just before I begin, I have a message to read out from a tribute and an appreciation of Jim Kerr from the Bishop-elect, the Reverend Canon Ian Ellis. Firstly, may I say how sorry I am not being able to be present today for this funeral service and service of thanksgiving for the life of Jim Kerr. However, I have asked the Dean to read this brief tribute to Jim on behalf of the Diocese of Clogher. This is, of course, a private family funeral, governed by the necessary restrictions due to the coronavirus pandemic. As a result, many people from across the diocese who would have wished to have been present are unable to be here to support you, to share your grief, and to express their respect and esteem for Jim. Jim Kerr's long and distinguished career as a teacher is well known. It came to full circle in the last position he held as principal of Jones Memorial Primary, a school he also attended as a pupil himself. He will, of course, be remembered by professional colleagues, parents, and pupils as a much respected and admired teacher and principal. He was an excellent principal of Jones Memorial, and his contribution to education of young people in Fermanagh is widely acknowledged and greatly respected. I know too that the present principal, and governors of Jones would wish me to express their appreciation of his professionalism and friendship, and to offer their condolences to you, his family, in your loss. For churches and parents, it's been so important to have such a person of faith bringing the values of Christianity to the ethos of the school. And so we are thankful to God for Jim's gift to education. However, I wish also today to express the appreciation of the Diocese of Clogher for the immense contribution Jim has made as a layman to the life of the diocese. Clergy in particular are thankful for his ministry as a diocesan reader over many years, as he willingly undertook to cover services to allow them to take a holiday. The clergy always knew that their Sunday services were in capable hands of a person of faithfulness, sincerity, and spirituality. Jim was one of the first in the diocese to be commissioned as a diocesan reader, and he has given an outstanding service for almost 40 years. Jim was a faithful member of the Church of Ireland. Because of his teaching and background, he had a particular interest in nurturing young minds in Bible and teachings of the Church. For many years, he's given a tremendous service as chairman of the Clogher Diocesan Board of Religious Education. But this was but one of the many committees of the Church that Jim served on. He has been a long-standing member of the Diocesan Synod and Council, its boards, and served for many years as a diocesan representative of the General Synod. In fact, there are very few roles as a layman in the Church that Jim has not held. He's also served in the wider educational setting in both the Fermanagh Protestant Board and the Pretoria Royal School Board of Governors. Jim's contribution to the Church of Ireland and Clogher and in the field of education in the country has simply been immense. And today we acknowledge his outstanding service and thank Almighty God for his willingness to offer his gifts to the Lord of the Church and to this community. And to his family, his nearest and dearest, we offer our sincere sympathy, and we pray that you may know the love and esteem in which Jim is held by the members of this diocese and beyond, and that you be given the grace and strength to bear this loss and to trust in God, whom Jim dedicated his life to serving. So we thank God today for the life and every remembrance we hold of our friend, our fellow servant, and Brother Jim, and commend him to the keeping of God. Thank you to our Bishop-elect, Ian, for that message. I want to thank at this particular time as well all the carers over the past years for both Jim and for Dorothy, for the medical team and the Marie Curie over this past few days. And may I also say a sincere thank you to you, Jim's closest family, for the love and the care you gave him, allowing him to die at home and to be there for him at every turn round. Thank you. Thank you to Diane for playing the organ today, to Claire for singing her hymns, to David Robertson, who will be playing for Lexi, who's going to sing a solo. So may God bless our time together. We meet in the name of Christ, who died and was raised by the glory of God the Father. Grace and mercy be with you all. We've come here today to remember before God our dear brother Jim, to give thanks for his life, to leave him in the keeping of God as Creator, Redeemer and Judge, to commit his body to be buried, and to comfort one another in our grief, in the hope that is ours, through the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Therefore we pray that here today we may know the peace of Christ in communion with all God's faithful servants. We stand. God of all consolation, whose Son Jesus Christ was moved to tears at the grave of Lazarus, his friend, look with compassion on us, your children, our loss. Give to our troubled hearts the light of hope, and strengthen us the gift of faith in Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
so my soul longs after you. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship you. You alone are my strength, my shield. To you
standing. As children of a loving Heavenly Father, let us seek the forgiveness of God, for He is full of gentleness and compassion. Call to remembrance, O Lord, your compassion and your loving kindness, for they have been from of old. Lord, have mercy. Remember not my sins nor my transgressions, but according to your mercy, think on me. Christ, have mercy. O keep my life and deliver me. Put me not to shame, for I have put my trust in you. Lord, have mercy. May God our Father forgive us our sins and bring us to eternal joy of his kingdom, where dust and ashes have no dominion. Amen. Let us pray. As we come into God's presence in prayer, we remember especially the family circle at this time. We remember especially Dorothy, who's unable to be present with us today. We remember Jim. We give thanks for his life. And we think of ourselves in the presence of Almighty God. Merciful Father, hear our prayers and comfort us. Renew our trust in your Son whom you raised from the dead. Strengthen our faith, that all who have died in the love of Christ will share in his resurrection, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
First scripture reading is from 1 Corinthians chapter 2, beginning at verse 6. Yet among the mature, we do speak wisdom, though it is not a wisdom of this age or of the rulers of this age, who are doomed to perish. But we speak God's wisdom, secret and hidden, which God decreed before the ages for our glory. None of the rulers of this age understood this, for if they had, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. But as it is written, what no eye has seen, nor ear heard, nor the human heart conceived, what God has prepared for those who love him. These things God has revealed to us through the Spirit, for the Spirit searches everything, even the depths of God. For what human being knows what is truly human, except the human spirit that is within? So also, no one comprehends what is truly God's, except the Spirit of God. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks
be to God.
We remain seated and will say in alternate verses the Psalm 121. I will lift up my eyes unto the hills, from whence cometh my help. He will not suffer thy foot to be moved, he that keepeth thee will not sleep. The Lord himself is thy keeper, the Lord is thy defence upon thy right hand. The Lord shall preserve thee from all evil, yet is even he that shall keep thy soul. Glory be to the Father, to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
A reading from St. John, chapter 14, beginning at verse 1. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. And you know the way to the place where I am going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way? Jesus said to him, I am the way, and the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not let them be afraid. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Thank you.
I, the Lord of sea and sky, I have heard my people cry, all who dwell in dark and sin, my hand will save. I who made the stars of night, I will make their darkness bright. Who will bear my light to them? Whom shall I send? Here I am, Lord. Is it I, Lord? I have heard you come.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Thank you, Lexi. You have done your grandpa proud. Wasn't sure whether you would make it through that or not, but you did, certainly did. So thank you. James, or better known as Jim, was born on the 8th of February, 1935. A Friday's child, loving and giving. He was the eldest of four boys to Hugh and Caroline Kerr of Culkey in Enniskillen. Jim is predeceased by two of his brothers, the Reverend Cecil and Mervyn, and survived by his younger brother, Derek, who's watching online at the moment. Being brought up on a traditional small farm, he quickly learned the importance of hard work and perseverance, as well as respect and love of nature and life. It was, without doubt, that his early experience influenced his eventual career choice. Jim had a welcoming smile for everyone, which became his trademark, and he was known in many circles as Gentleman Jim. His early education was in the Old Jones Memorial School, where he reported he once got caught sharpening the teacher's cane, called Harry, in the pencil sharpener, causing the then teacher to exclaim loudly, "Who sharpened Harry?" He, of course, owned up and subsequently had a close encounter with Harry. He progressed to Patura Royal School, where he learned and developed his love for the game of rugby, as well as the sciences. In the absence of school buses, Jim cycled to school every day and was often referred to by the neighbours when seen passing by, "There goes Culkey Jim." Jim then moved on to Stranmiller's Teaching Training College, where he completed his training as a teacher of science, and was there that he met some of his lifelong friends and continued his beloved sport of rugby. His first teaching post was in the newly formed Enniskillen High School as a teacher of rural sciences, and his mark can still be seen there today in the planted shrubberies that he planted as part of the curriculum, as well as after-school activities, gaining him the nickname the Shrub Man. Early in his career, he moved into primary school teaching and became a teaching principal in Lack Primary School, where he spent a number of very happy years perfecting his art before moving to Balnamallard Primary as a teaching principal and then to Jones Memorial School as principal. He looked back on those years in these schools with great pride, but he had a special place in his heart for the school that he attended himself as a boy, Jones Memorial, and was thrilled to be invited back on many occasions after he retired. Even after he retired, he still loved contact with children and school environment. He hosted joint visits of year four classes from Enniskillen Integrated Primary that visited both here and St Michael's Church. He spoke at assemblies in Enniskillen Integrated Primary when roped in by his daughter-in-law Adele, and facilitated tours of the cathedral for post-primary RE students. He also had an amazing talent of remembering every student's name that he taught, no matter how long it was ago. On retiring, Jim also achieved a lifetime ambition in travelling on the Glacier Express. He and his daughter Helen headed for 10 days in Switzerland and climbed every mountain and walked round every lake and listened to every cowbell. A special moment of this trip was visit to Geneva and the history of Lutheranism. Jim met his future bride-to-be in what we would now consider a blind date. Whilst attending a barbecue at Carrickray off the Shore Road with his good friend Ivan Lone and his girlfriend Martha, they happened to bump into Martha's sister Dorothy, and he charmed her away from her Canadian admirer. And so on the second anniversary of their meeting, the two couples got married, a double wedding in Enniskillen Methodist Church on the 14th of July, 1958. Amazingly, yesterday I was looking at Dorothy's nursing diary, and the 14th of July just has a circle around it. It gives all the appointments of every other day, but it just gives a circle around the 14th of July. There's no mention of the wedding, holiday, or anything else. That's all. It's just the dates just circled. Jim and Dorothy set up home at Cobo, at Rakeelan Glebe, in Enniskillen, where he was blessed with two children, or they were blessed with two children, Andrew and Helen. The family home remains at Rakeelan Glebe on the Mullaghmeen Road. Jim always gave freely and readily of his time, and his list of involvements is endless, and I'm not sure whether I'm going to cover them all or not. But here goes. He was actively involved as a fundraiser and a committee member for the Ulster Cancer Foundation, and even up until last year continued to raise funds through contributions made towards tomato plants that he grew. He kept bees, and for a time was a member of Fermanagh Beekeepers. I enjoyed this story, and the family enjoyed this story of hearing the story of Jim as when he was principal of Ballinamallard Primary School, arrived one morning with a rather swollen face. Jim had to call all the children into the assembly hall and to explain to them that he had been stung by the bees and they were not to be afraid of him. Being a lifelong badminton player, he played for the Cathedral Badminton Club right up until his mid-50s. He, along with his friend, the late Ronnie Woods, started the Cathedral Junior Badminton Club, which he ran every Saturday night and welcomed children from all traditions. They would have probably been able to secure a lottery grant for sport development in today's world. Inspired by his love of rugby, he introduced and coached mini rugby in Ballymallard and Jones Memorial, and regularly made it to the Northern Ireland finals at Ravenhill. An experience which encouraged many a young boy to pursue sport at a higher level. His interest in rugby gave him great pleasure, and may I say, frustrations as well in later years, following his beloved Ulster provincial team and, of course, Ireland. Many a word of encouragement could be heard hurled at the TV or the radio during a match. He was a member of the Board of Governors of Patora Royal School for over 20 years, a role which he was very proud of and reluctantly stepped down from as his health declined. He was a keen gardener and regularly gave talks on topics at many organisations. He spent any free time he had in his own garden, establishing shrub beds at the family home, growing vegetables, in his greenhouse growing tomato plants, and often he went round to visit Jim. Dorothy would say, he's up in the garden, and up would go to the garden and you'd find him in the greenhouse. He grew his tomato plants from seeds, and he was always very proud of them, and they ended up in tomatoes ended up in many Fermanagh homes and beyond. Jim was a man of immense faith and lived life accordingly. He loved his church and served as church warden and on the Slack vestry. He was a Sunday school teacher and became the Sunday school superintendent for more than 50 years. When he retired from that office, he requested that contributions made towards a presentation should go to the funding of the audiovisual system. That was in 2004, costing then £1,520. Jim was a most willing helper in the parish, whether that involved office, gardening. And you know, he was a major player in converting the foundations of the old parish hall, which is my present deanery back garden, by laying topsoil. And I remember Sam was walking down there the other day and he was telling me that him and Jim Kerr spread the topsoil over my back garden. He was also very involved in decorating and painting the old cathedral hall. He trained as a diocesan lay reader and served for over 40 years, travelling the length and the breadth of Clogher Diocese, On his Sundays off, he would assist in the cathedral, and when I came here 11 years ago, he helped out with communion on Sundays. In conducting visitors' tours at the cathedral, he demonstrated a highly informed level of knowledge of the cathedral and its history. As well as a diocesan reader, Jim was in diocesan council as a parochial nominator. He was chairman of the Board of Religious Education. He was a governor on the Clogher Diocesan Board of Education. He was on Diocesan Synod, General Synod, the Episcopal Electoral College, Diocesan Court, a supplemental diocesan nominator. He's a member of Fermanagh Protestant Board of Education. He was a diocesan ministry team of healing committee. And I could go on probably more. I probably have missed several. Jim was one who put faith into action. As well as all of the above, he supported several missionary organisations. Despite all of that and everything else, Jim was a loving and devoted husband, father and grandfather. He loved the fact that his granddaughter Lexi would follow the tradition of attending the big school on the hill, and he loved hearing of her many accomplishments in music and at school, and he'd be very proud of you today for that singing. Over Lexi's adoption, Jim relished the fact that he travelled to London for a day in 2005 with Adele's father, Tom. They both took on and won the bureaucracy of the Mexican embassy. There were some papers that were to be signed in Mexico, and they weren't going to go on another trip back to Mexico, so they realised that the Mexican embassy really is Mexico. And they went to London to sign the forms in the Mexican embassy. And I believe they took on the bureaucracy of the embassy and they won their case. And I believe they were reportedly seen doing a jig of celebration outside the embassy to the amusement of the police officers that were watching. Helen and Andrew will be forever grateful for the wide variety of experiences that Jim allowed them. From horses to motorbikes, swimming in Derrychara Pool, boating and water skiing in Loch Earn, family camping holidays, and I believe always setting off late, as Jim would always be late. I never realised that Jim would always be late, but he was maybe of some other excuse, maybe of cutting hay before he'd go on holidays, or something else needed to be done, losing suitcases on the roof of the wreck of the Mini. And I believe this was a rather strange one. He nearly missed the Larne Stranraer ferry, having dropped off Dorothy and Helen while he went to park the car at Cecil's house. And I think he talked too long to Cecil that they were getting on the wrong boat. So no matter where the family went on holiday, Jim always found a garden centre which had to be visited. The bigger, the better. I believe he used to book the holidays, and I think Dorothy hated holidays because she had all the arrangements to do and Jim just booked it. She had the work to do. Andrew and Helen will also be grateful that he always supported them in their decisions in their careers. He loved his lengthy education discussions with Adele and kept up to date with the changes and developments in education. But above all of that, Jim deserves a lot of credit for the way he devoted himself to Dorothy's care over this past 10 years from the onset of dementia. Jim knew about this long before the family or anyone else knew about it. And in fact, I would say he kept it hidden to look after her himself. Despite all his health issues over this past 6 years, he still was her primary carer. Thank you, Jim, the love and the care that you give to your wife, Dorothy. And I know the family will take great comfort from and would like everyone to know that they are very grateful for all the lovely messages on Facebook. And I just looked at my mobile phone there when the lesson was being read and I saw the messages are coming flying in on the YouTube videos now at the moment of the appreciation of people that are saying things of Jim. Something like gentleman, legend, of one kind, one of a kind. And there's also one saying safe in the arms of Jesus, and also safe in the knowledge that Jim is now happy at home with his Lord and Saviour. As on that last comment, I want to turn to an amazing end to an amazing earthly life. When I was at the house on Sunday afternoon, I could see for the first time Jim was in great pain. However, when I spoke to him, his words were, "Ah, my friend." He took out his hand. I struggled to get his hand out to shake my hand briefly. I only spoke to him briefly in that window of opportunity, that small window of opportunity I had. And I said to Jim, "I'll read you a psalm and pray with you." I started to read the 121st Psalm. That's why it's on your sheet today. And amazingly, Jim, in his weakness, started to recite the psalm with me. "I will lift up my eyes to the hills. From where does my help come? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. He will not let your foot be moved. He who keeps you will not slumber. Behold, he who keeps Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord is your keeper. The Lord is your shade at your right hand." Jim knew those words so well. Not only knew the words, but also knew of whom they spoke of. The Lord is your keeper. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. Jim lived those words. He relied on the Lord for everything he did. No matter how bad things seemed, he would praise God for what he had. Most of you, and probably you who are listening online, all knew him. So there's not a lot I can say to you that you don't already know. He was the epitome of what a Christian should be. And I don't think there was ever a time that I talked to him he wasn't praising the Lord for something. Psalm 121 is sometimes called the Traveller's Psalm. It's a psalm sung by pilgrims as they made their annual journey to Jerusalem. It expressed their faith in God, but also reflected the unease they felt about travel. "I will lift up my eyes to the hills, from whence cometh my help." Strange, isn't it? Hills are not places where help really comes from. Rather, they are places where help is needed. Here in this psalm, the hills of the mountains represent the perils of the journey, for it is the mountain ranges that the wild beasts and robbers hid. As the pilgrims looked to the mountain ranges ahead, they had to cross. If they were to reach Jerusalem, they were filled with foreboding and wondered where their help would come from. In this situation, the psalmist declares, "My help comes from the Lord, who made heaven and earth." That what was true then remains true today. As we go through the ups and downs and the twists and turns of life, our help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. And there is no doubt that Jim knew all about that, especially on Sunday afternoon. When I called to see him, Jim was in no doubt on a journey at that stage. His earthly life was ebbing out. He was a traveller on a known journey to a known destination, yet for him, yet unseen destination. On the course of this journey, he started to recite with me those well-known words of the psalmist, very much words of comfort and meaning to him. "I will lift up my eyes to the hills. From where does my help come? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth." However, I only read half of that psalm just a few moments ago, because in the midst of that psalm, Jim faded away. Much further down the road, homeward bound, I finished the psalm myself. I prayed in his presence and gave him a final blessing. And not many hours later, he arrived at his destination, into God's eternal care. Sadness for the family, mixed with joy for Jim. He has now experienced what the scripture reading tells us of one we read earlier, what no eye has seen, nor ear has heard, nor the human heart conceived, what God has prepared for those who love him. No more sorrow or suffering. Death will be no more. Mourning, crying, and pain will be no more. For the former things have passed away, and all things are made new. Yes, a place worthy of travelling to. And for those of us who are left behind, we are still travelling. And we as travellers need to remember that God is there too to help us on our journey, if we but let him. God doesn't force himself upon us, but he is there if we want to turn to him for help. God doesn't guarantee that difficulties will never occur, but he does promise that when trouble arises, he will be by our side. The psalmist ends with the statement, "The Lord will keep your going out and your coming in from this time forth forevermore." And I believe this was particularly true for Jim in his last few months of difficulties, and especially in his last few days of difficulties. Jim kept positive. He was there right up to the end, and now God has taken him into his eternal care. Yes, in all life's experiences, in its sorrows and its joys, in its failures and its successes, at its beginning and its ending, God is there to give the help that really counts if we but open ourselves to receive him into our lives. So today, we give not just thanks for Jim, but also for the God who sustained Jim in this life and will continue to sustain him in the next. May Jim rest in peace and rise in glory. And now to God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit be all praise, honour, and glory this day and forevermore. Amen. We confess our Christian faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us pray. Father of all, in whom we are one with your saints, we remember with thanksgiving those whom we love but see no longer. We thank you for your servant Jim. We thank you for every memory of love and of joy, for every good deed done by him, and for every happiness that we have shared with him. We thank you for his life. We thank you for his commitment to serve you. We thank you for everything that was good and true. But now we thank you for the rest in Christ he so now enjoys. And we rejoice in your promise of eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord, in whom the bond of love is never broken. Amen. Almighty God, Father of all mercies and giver of all comfort, deal graciously, we pray, with those who mourn. We remember especially his wife Dorothy, son Andrew, daughter Helen, daughter-in-law Adele and son-in-law Don, his granddaughter Lexi, his brother Derek, sister-in-laws Myrtle and Margaret, but all the family circle, neighbours and friends, and all who loved and worked with Jim and served on committees with him. Comfort them with your gracious consolation. Strengthen them to meet the days to come with steadfastness and patience, not sorrowing as those without hope, but in thankful remembrance of your mercy in the past and waiting for a joyful reunion in heaven. In Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And a prayer for ourselves, knowing that one day too we will have to come to this place called death. Grant us, Lord, the wisdom and the grace to use aright the time we have left here on earth. Lead us to repent of our sins, the evil we have done and the good we have not done, and strengthen us to follow the steps of your Son in the ways that lead to the fullness of eternal life, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. We pray together the prayer on our sheet. Heavenly Father, in your Son, Jesus Christ, you've given us a true faith and a sure hope. Strengthen this faith and hope in us all our days, that we may live as those who believe in the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, and the resurrection to eternal life, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And together we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen.
Be thou my vision, O Lord of my heart. Not be all else to me, save that thou art. Thou my best thought in the day and the night. Thank you.
Our help is in the name of the Lord, who has made heaven and earth. We just keep silence for a moment. God, our Creator and Redeemer, by your power, Christ conquered death and entered into glory. Confident of his victory and claiming his promises, we now leave your servant Jim in your gracious keeping. In the name of Jesus our Lord, who died and is alive, and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Lord, now lettest thou thy servant depart in peace, according to thy word. For mine eyes have seen thy salvation, which thou hast prepared before the face of all people, to be a light to lighten the Gentiles, to be the glory of thy people Israel. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.